Mr. Doctor. charge of the court clerk. Mr. Chairman, I have one vote of 31 present.
Very well. There you go. The clerk has reported the presence of a quorum. The committee will consider its continuous consideration of H.R. 493 as a genetic information non-discrimination Non-Discrimination Act of 2007. The last part of the business before the committee was a motion by Mr. Waxman, the gentleman from California, dispensing the reading bill. Without objection, the gentleman's motion is dispensed with. The bill will be considered as read in open to a limited time. The chair would now like to make a couple of quick observations. This bill is an important legislation. It would prohibit discrimination by health insurance plans and employers because of someone's genetic information. The legislation adds 219 bipartisan co-sponsors and broad support from distinguished medical and health organizations. President Bush has twice supported this bill in a statement of administration policy. It was quoted this year as saying that he wanted, quote, the Congress to pass legislation that makes genetic discrimination illegal. This bill has been under negotiation for 12 years now, most recently for the last 2 months. The staffs on both sides of the aisle spent enormous amounts of time attempting to reach amendment. The priority has been afforded numerous concessions, a lot of time on discussions, and the staffs have worked together to point where I look that we are legally disposing of matters successfully. Now, the committee recessed yesterday afternoon to enable additional good faith negotiations with our good friends on the ground. That action is extremely rare and require the chair to seek additional time from the speaker so that the committee could continue this note today. The majority of staff held discussions until 2 a.m. with our friends on the ground to work through the various outstanding concerns. The staff of the majority has compromised with the ground, and we've offered generous managers and members to address the 6 issues they've communicated. That's their most expressive concerns. There are many issues with policy disputes, but we think that we may perhaps have resolved that, and then we will find out how that process has succeeded or failed if we proceed with the bill at this time. The chair will recognize my colleagues for purposes of the amendments of the proper order that we will offer, and then we will offer a manager's amendment. We will try to move speedily to favorably report this legislation to the House. Does any member desire to make an opening statement this day? Gentlemen from Texas, my friend, will be recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The bill before us, H.R. 493, the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, is a very important piece of legislation. Because if it becomes law, it creates a new civil rights violation. It creates, in some cases, new and new class action lawsuit potential. So this is not just any old bill. It is attempting to address an issue that is becoming more and more important as our scientists and medical researchers unlock more and more of the secrets of the human genome and expand the boundaries of what we know about genetics. So it's important that if we're going to pass legislation that we get it right to the extent possible. This particular bill, like several bills of its kind, that as they near fruition, the original sponsors and authors become much endeared of specific language, and it's almost like a favorite child that you think is perfect, and that there's no way that you can discipline that child. Those of us in the minority are trying to be positive in perfecting the bill. And I am proud to report that with the cooperation and support of Chairman Dingell and Subcommittee Chairman Cologne, the majority of minority staffs have worked with minority staffs, myself, up Mr. Baptist, Ms. Morocco, and all those on our side, and we have a manager's amendment that does approve the vote, and that's a good thing. Those on the minority that have tried to make some changes and have not done it, just out of the orderliness of trying to change something, we've actually done it because we think this bill's going to become law, and we want the best public vote possible. And the manager's amendment does do that. We have several amendments, one by Dr. Murphy and one by Congressman Starrett, that are going to be offered that we think, if passed, will approve the bill. There is a policy disagreement about that, and that's why we have open debate and open lockups. And once we dispense with those two amendments, we're very willing to go to the manager's amendment and then support trying to deal with that, waiting some time so that the bill gets to the floor in an expeditious fashion, so that we meet our jurisdictional referral and keep the work product in this committee relevant. So, Mr. Chairman, we appreciate your willingness to work and negotiate with the minority. We think that the work product in this committee is definitely an improvement on the bill that came into the committee. Quite frankly, this is a shit bill dealing with bad history and energy planners for me. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
From New Jersey, Mr. Pallone is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to reiterate my strong support for this legislation. I think that it goes without saying that everyone in this room wants to protect a person's genetic information from being abused or used against them to discriminate. We all recognize that while genetic testing holds the possibility of providing better treatment, it also holds the possibility of remission. With the increasing prevalence of genetic testing comes the growing field of potential to misuse this information by way of discrimination in health insurance and employment. And the legislation before us seeks to prevent both types of discrimination from taking place and gives individuals the peace of mind that their genetic information will be adequately protected. And my friends on the other side of the aisle have been trying to narrow the scope of the bill. Their concerns, as far as I can see, are that the bill is currently drafted with an act promoting sweeping changes to our health care system, employment sector, as well as other areas such as law enforcement, essentially rendering them feckless to perform certain core functions. Now, I would stress it should come as no surprise to anyone that we disagree on policy. But contrary to what was portrayed yesterday at the beginning of the markup, I believe that we have tried very hard to work with our minority committee members to address their concerns. We made a pledge in the subcommittee last week that we would further discuss the minority's concerns as we head into the full committee markup, and that we would try our very best to reach a consensus with them. I strongly believe that we live up to that pledge. I know for a fact that the staff of both parties have spent many hours of meetings along with outside stakeholders trying to reach an agreement on some of the outstanding issues. As we head into the markup yesterday, we presented what we thought was at that moment in time the best package we could offer. It was not accepted by the Republicans for various reasons. Of course, then the events of yesterday unfolded, and we held a members level meeting where we agreed to have the staff try again to negotiate on a smaller universe of outstanding issues that the Republicans raised. And since staff were communicating until about 2 a.m. last night, as well as continued discussions right up to a few moments ago. And I only raise this to highlight this process because I want to be clear and for the record to show that this has been a fair process. At the end of the day, we may have to realize that we disagree on some policy issues, but let us not discount the hours of hard work that both members and staff on both sides of the aisle put to reach a compromise. We were successful on some fronts, but not on everyone, but not for lack of trying. In closing, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for all of your efforts, and I just want to say that the time to enact this bill into law has arrived. The legislation is strong bipartisan support in Congress. The short of all of this is that this bill has been slowed far too long. Ms. Sawyer said, I think she's been working on it for 14 years. And the reason this legislation has languished for over a decade is because the House has consistently failed to act. That's going to change shortly. We'll mark up this bill, send it to the floor for final passage, and get it to the president's desk. We're closer to that goal than ever before. It's time for the House to do its part to make this happen, and that will be thanks to this committee. Thank you.
to the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a concern that this point of information, Mr. Chairman. You know, one of those primary people that I work with, so I have one of those offerings except that they're in the memory of not to put this on the statement in the record, and they have not. And it's the same right to mark up. But I don't want to do that to divide people, but there's a majority. As a strong feeling for the open statements fine, but I think none of us know the buildings that the poor statements is. And so, Mr. Chairman, I ask you to ask myself that the open statements be heard and we move to the work of the law.
Thank you. Let's try and see what members want to make an opening statement. And as the gentleman would yield to the chairman, how many members wish to make an opening statement on this matter? I see, Mr. Brewer, and the child will inform the members that without objection, they will be statements that members want will be inserted in the record for that big point. Chair recognizes now the gentleman in the name of Mr. Brewer for the opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, my opening statement is complimentary. In this committee, we're keeping good public policy, and it gave us that opportunity through the night. To my colleagues, the issue is it's the free flow of information between the VA and DOD. So all of you find out that pitches about Walter Reed and the complaints about soldiers and tackling the bureaucracy, the last thing you want to do is create additional barriers. The whole future about seamless transition between DOD and the VA is how information flow can be bidirectional, interoperable, and in real time. Those are the three substantive issues. And so when we try to do that, we deal with it with the HIPAA legislation. And the last thing we want to do is throw in another piece of legislation that causes confusion as we're trying to bring this seamless transition and free flow of medical information. So, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for working with us. And I believe that your manager's amendment is going to address some of my concerns. And so I want to thank the chairman for causing this committee so we can do substantive work. I feel better.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For me, the chairman now knows that there are two amendments that need to be offered, so the chairman recognizes first, I would thank the chair, Mr. Stearns. And the court will approve the amendment.
Mr. Chairman, can I start for that one? I just have
a question here. Without objection, gentlemen,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to answer before we start for the application of our amendments, just a question to counsel. And the first question I have for you is we do not read the definition of genome, which is the acronym for the bill, as requiring the genotypes to be related in any way related to disease. Do you read any requirement that the detection of genotypes within this paragraph is limited to genotypes related to genetic diseases, disorders, or pathological conditions? And I say that to the council, noting Mr. Dio, the ranking member of health, asked Dr. Francis Collins certain questions relating to detects a genotype. We understand Mr. Collins stated that tumor typing is initially covered in the bill, but there is an exception for analysis of proteins for manifest diseases in Title I, direct analysis of DNA, RNA, or chromosomes for tumor typing. However, these might fall within the exception of Title I. This is a bit esoteric, but the question is that Dr. Francis Collins, when asked questions about the definition, sorry, I'm disputing the very fact of the definition which is in this bill. So I go back to my original question in terms of this definition. Do you read any requirements that the detection of genotypes within this paragraph is limited to genotypes related to genetic diseases, disorders, or pathological conditions? Is that clear enough for you? I'm not sure how I can make it clear. Counsel will respond. Find me place to the exact language in the bill I'm referring to. I cannot. It's the other than the definition,
201 is the actual definition of a parent. Page 61. The term genetic testing means the analysis of human DNA, RNA, etc. The section. Again, the candidate can probably make it in, or restate the question. Yes, we do not read the definition of genetic testing as a method. Any requirements that the detection of genotypes within this paragraph is limited. It's limited to genotypes related to genetic diseases, disorders, and pathological conditions. No. The answer is no. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I just have one more question here. I'm still recognizing that in 40 seconds. Given the complexity of the relationships of genetics to diseases, many state laws have explicit exclusions to ensure certain activities would not be affected by prohibitions. Please tell us whether genome would or would not, or plasmid could come to the following: routine physical measurements, tests for abuse of drugs related to occupational safety, for example, commercial drivers or heavy machine operators; C, tests for the presence of the human immunodeficiency virus; and D, test of office records in the event of an avian flu outbreak or bioterrorism event, setting a traps. Again, the state has explicit exclusion to ensure these things would not be prohibited. But our understanding is that the four that I announced to you would not follow the state law, and in fact, preempt the state law. Is that your understanding? No. So you're saying that the bill is right now, the four things that I mentioned, which the states have explicit exclusions of, you agree with the states? I'm not sure I understand that question. Well, I'm not sure you don't understand. I don't understand what you don't understand. True, you don't understand. Well, that means it's probably not complicated. First of all, I don't have any problem with the state laws to get you to the problem. Well, if there was any different comparison in the state laws, I think it's a fundamental question. It seems it would be another with the German news for the front line of opposition, but I'm sure. I think the question is, does the bill as drawn preempt state law? States permitted to act. Is that the question? That's the question. Okay. So, what's the answer to that question,
Johnson? Activities that are in the scope of GI would be perhaps state laws to the extent that state laws are less stringent. I think that going back to the original question, the issue with some of the tests to which you refer is that those are not designed to detect genotypes.
Exclusions in state law are still prevailing, are they preempted by this bill? You're exactly right, Mr. Chairman. So that's the question for you. What's the exclusions in the state law still prevailing or not?
If the state law has an exclusion for the scope of information that is covered by genome, that is purely genetic information, then the state law would be preempted against them. The claim for that thing is less stringent than genome would be preempted.
It's a general review. State law is preempted, accepting that if the state has more stringent constraints, that is not correct. Is that correct?
Yes or no?
Yes.
Page 29, strike 4. Page 29, 12, strike the period, and insert semicolon or page 20.
underlying parameters of the filing in the construction for limitations on genetic testing. D, to preclude group health plan or health insurance issuer from providing information to providers or individuals about genetic tests related to coverage of benefits, treatment alternatives, disease management, case management, care coordination, or prevention programs.
Mr. Chairman, I ask consent to waive the reading.
And the further reading of the amendment is dispensed. The gentleman from Pennsylvania is recognized for 5 minutes in support of these amendments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you so much for considering this amendment. We all know this bill should be about preventing discrimination and preventing health care. Well-intended purpose bill to prevent sharing information that would keep it from close to a question of job or health care coverage. I believe it will have an unintended consequence of preventing the sharing of information that otherwise could be used to treat disease. The treatment of chronic conditions consumes nearly 80% of healthcare costs in the United States. A complex chronic disease case requires coordination of treatments, medication, and health measures to ensure patients receive appropriate care. Any parent with a child with a chronic illness knows, or anyone whose parents or an employee knows, the heart-wrenching difficulty and complexity can be to track appointments, test results, pass information back and forth between providers, and most providers in many cases when you have special development case. When you have care management, and that is specialist patients, doctors, others will pass information back and forth, it saves lives and saves money. A Medicare comprehensive diabetes patient care management program involving more than 20,000 seniors reduced complications and yielded savings of some 1.5 million per 1,000 patients with diabetes. You know, University District Medical Center in Pittsburgh is managing patients with diabetes. Reduced rehospitalizations by 75%. A hospital in Washington, Pennsylvania, reduced rehospitalizations because of chronic heart disease by 50%. The cost savings and life savings are massive in this. But let us look when someone's working for an employer, that employer may have information about that patient or a physician may have information about a patient with regard to risks that that employee may have. Now, in my district, there's a lot of folks who have high-risk jobs working at coal mines, steel mills, and other places. Where if someone is in a situation where perhaps they have a chronic illness, I believe it is vital that that information be committed and shared back and forth between providers and specialists, health insurance plan, hazard information, to make sure they can manage that patient's care. It is one of the important modern changes in health care activities that can save massive amounts of money and save lives. I'm concerned that this bill, the way the wording currently exists, would not allow this care management to take place, would not allow this important and vital information to share between doctors and patients, and can actually lead to some other harm or risk. Now, I have asked counsel at the desk if you have any information at all which could tell me, on the other hand, that this bill does cover the ability to share information for the purpose of care and management might be willing to listen to me. But as a stand, I have nothing in this bill which specifically states that this is possible.
The chair will inform the gentleman that the question is directed to counsel around that. If you choose the gentleman wishes to answer.
Yes, I'd like to ask the chairman if you could direct counsel.
Just direct the question to the chairman and also would you like to counsel the answer? Chairman's right, please.
Mr. Chairman, I would appreciate if you could help me find information in this bill that would tell me that the care manager, case manager is still permissible. Otherwise, I think that this amendment is vitally important for the purpose of saving lives and saving money.
The counsel responded to the question.
It's done directly in two cases, and I would say that there's further language clarifying this point in the manager's amendment. First of all, 102C2, there's a rule of construction which deals with provision of health care. On page 8 of the committee report, there's also a rule of construction which is fairly important.
Mr. Chairman, could you ask me to read that section?
I'm sorry. Mr. Chairman, could you ask me to read that section you just referred to?
Would you read that section, please?
On page 19. Rule of construction, nothing in this part shall be constrained to limit the authority of the healthcare professional who is providing healthcare services with respect to an individual to request that such individual or family member of such individual undergo a genetic test. Nor shall it limit the authority of a healthcare professional who is employed by an affiliate with a group plan or health insurance issuer and who is providing healthcare services to an individual who is permanently notified by this
to identify such individuals with the availability of the medication. Mr. Chairman, quickly, in my time, this law, I'm talking about patients with chronic illness, secondary to tertiary prevention. I'm talking about people who may be dying. I'm talking about people who may have an accident in a coal mine or steel mill. I'm not referring to a bona fide wellness program. We're not talking about having people go on an exercise or an app. I'm talking about people who have a real disease. And I'm deeply concerned about these patients. And if we do not have the ability to share this information back and forth with doctors and patients, and I think we have that information, I believe that the consequences are quite dire. Would the gentleman yield?
We are in touch with gentlemen's right now for what I wish to do.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir. I still think that under that provision that the staff just read, it's clear that the health care provider can provide that information. I mean, the concern here is that, and I understand your concern, but I think the problem is that you're going too far. In other words, we want health insurers and providers to be able to look for information. Maybe that role should be able to provide, but on the other hand, we don't want the insurance company to be moving in the direction of mandating or telling the patient, if you will, what they should do.
But we think about that, and I would point out that since I live through something that's within my time here, that is that it is important that the plan does that indeed. And I'm not citing the charts, but I'm just citing the point that patients ought to be able to have that information shared with those who can provide it. A primary care provider, simply a specialist chronic illness, where the person may be seen a dozen different doctors or more, needs someone to help coordinate these cases. This is the way things are done now with care management. So because it's just too complex and people end up making a lot of mistakes and they end up getting harmed. So my concern is it's not the individual provider, it's the specialist, and they have someone who can coordinate that, which quite frankly, the best position oftentimes is the insurance plan who can do that and coordinate also sometimes the employers to make sure those employees are not harmed in the job. And I recognize my time is up, Mr. Chairman, but I would like to work for this amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I'm trying to jump on your message for the gentleman who found the judge, Mr. Pallone, in front of the subcommittee, and will offer his recognition to recognize him for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to stress that I understand that Mr. Murphy is trying to get out. I would point out that at the time, I guess about an hour and a half ago, we came back with a provision that I think would accomplish this goal. I mean, I have a basic belief that the underlying bill provides enough ability for the providers to get this information. But we did try to come back at around 9:15 this morning with a provision that would seek to accomplish this goal and clarify it even better. And that was supported by all the different groups that have been involved in negotiations and support this bill, as well as the sponsor, Ms. Slaughter, and that I think unfortunately was rejected. The problem is that if you go too far in allowing the insurance company to a point where they actually mandate or impact the choice of the individual, then you start to get into the whole discrimination issue. And so I think that faced with what Mr. Murphy is suggesting as opposed to the original language, we should stick with the original language. And we were trying to work this out with another provision that maybe would have moved in his direction. But that was rejected. So under the circumstances, I think there's less mischief for the bill by keeping the original language rather than the amendment he's proposing. And for that reason, I would yield as the amendment.
Would the gentleman yield?
The gentleman yield? Yes, I would certainly yield. Back to what Mr. Murphy had. The wording that was offered is not clear that you're referring to. Simply reads paragraph 1 shall not be construed to limit the authority of a group health plan to provide information generally about the availability of genetic tests, or B, to provide information about genetic tests to a healthcare professional with respect to the treatment of an individual tumor, and such professionals is providing healthcare services. So, in other words, the amendment that was offered in exchange was simply saying that we could provide information to patients that tests are available. It really does not provide for exchange of information back and forth of the physician and to treat a patient to
opposed to clashes of what that person may need to do on so many different levels. The healthcare is far in advance beyond just providing information to the patient, but I think if all we can offer the patient is social information, say some tests are bad, but doesn't really help treat those who are considered 80% of healthcare costs, or cases that are so complex that they can't possibly know and manage the difficulties of these cases, so I can get back.
I just think there's a difference in policy there, and I don't think there's anything in the underlying government that prohibits in any way the healthcare professional recommending testing, suggesting testing, or whatever to the individual. The problem here is that we just don't want the insurance companies to become involved in the individual's healthcare choice or discussions, because then that gets to the underlying question of discrimination. So I think there's just a basic difference in policy here that perhaps can just not be worked out. I would oppose the government's amendment.
Mr. Chairman,
I would continue to work with our colleagues to try and perfect these amendments and to build those through the legislative process. Special further, Mr. Chairman, the gentleman from Texas State Recreation Board that we have in support of the families recognized for that
they'll take 5 minutes. I just want members to focus, look at the section that the council just referred to. And this goes to one of the underlying continued problems in the bill. The section of the bill that's been referred to simply prohibits a healthcare company, healthcare provider, health plan from requiring that the individual take a genetic test. And then the exception is there's nothing that prevents the healthcare professional from requesting that the individual undergo a genetic test. But in the basic hit to the underlying cause of Dr. Murphy, is that there's a lot of information that really has nothing to do with genetic testing that could be construed under the definition section of this bill to be genetic. And Dr. Murphy is simply saying, we're not trying to require genetic testing. We're not saying that individuals can't be made aware that there are genetic tests available. We're trying to say that a health plan and healthcare professionals can practice routine medicine, which we, blood tests and things like this, that have not traditionally been called genetic tests under the definitional section of this bill, could be. So we're trying to protect the conventional, traditional practice of medicine. And Dr. Murphy's amendment is narrowing so that it's for health plans, if I understand it correctly. That's all he's trying to do. That what we've been doing for all these years can still be known and not be constrained as a genetic test. And as far as he can tell, and as far as I can tell, there's no way he feel that that's enough. So we hope that the majority will continue to work with Dr. Murphy so that as we go to the floor and go to conference, we can find common ground on this, because we do not want the unintended consequence to be a year from now when this bill is law, somebody does a blood test and they're sued because that blood test is reported and that's construed to be genetic information. Is that a good point?
The gentleman revealed his breaking word that I'm continuing working with our friends on the line, and I'll try to come up with a solution we can show through the potential of that physical question. If there's no further discussion of it, I'm sorry. The third purpose of gentlemen will say thank you. They have an amendment at the desk, Mr. Chair. We have an amendment to our business for that, and I refer actually to gentlemen who recognize our next. The work now occurs on the amendment offered by the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Murphy. Favorable signified by the side of that. Opposed none. Those who have it, but we will have a short announcement for our agreement. All in favor of the amendment will hold up their hands.
vote. Mr. Chairman, I don't think there were 18 ayes, 31 nays.
And it's not the way to government. California has an amendment. The first report to the amendment posted by the gentleman from California.
Amendment to H.R. 493, reported by the Secretary of Public Administration of California, page 29, after line 3, at the end of the new section.
Without objection, the reading of the amendment is dispensed with. Say this gentleman from California is recognized for 5 minutes of supply for
amendment. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not going to take up 5 minutes on this, but I, what we were reviewing the bill and discussing different parts of it at the subcommittee, I, along with others, raised concerns about something that I think is a flaw in the bill. Now, the bill has been around for some time, as you all know, 10, 12 years. And I think, with all due respect to the drafters of the legislation, that this was an area that simply was not anticipated at the time. But the flaw that I'm referring to is that long-term care insurance policies are not included under JDAC. And I believe, and I think others see this as well, that as a result, insurance providers will be allowed to adjust and deny long-term care insurance to an applicant based on their genetic information. So I have serious concerns about this omission. Others have raised their voices about it as well. In discussing this with the chairman of the full committee, with the chairman of the subcommittee on health, they have indicated that we will have separate hearings and look into this. But I do believe that it's an area for much mischief. Some have said that this is a different kind of policy. I don't believe it is. I think it's a health insurance product. And that's why I raise it. And I think that increasingly there will be more and more Americans that could very well be affected by the omission. And so I'm offering the amendment. I am going to withdraw it. And if there's anyone that would like to
answer,
I can yield. Certainly, Mr. Waxman, I'd be glad to hear.
Thank you very much for your interview. I think you've identified a very important issue regarding underwriting practices. To long-term care insurance policies, and in fact, they've become even more problematic as we enter an era where genetic tests become increasingly available and utilized. Unfortunately, trying to apply the provision of this bill, which will develop to expand the protections of HIPAA related to health insurance and to protect against employment discrimination on the basis of genetic information, is both complicated and frankly insufficient to address the issues related to long-term care insurance. We can take an extremely important step forward with this bill in the area of health insurance, where protections against discriminatory pricing and coverage practices might otherwise result in from genetic testing. And where knowledge of genetic predispositions can result in preventive practices and treatments that can save lives. Unfortunately, trying to fit the protections of the bottom of long-term care insurance. And frankly, depends on risk segmentation, which certainly depends upon the action of the bill we've got. I believe this committee should be very clear that we do not condone long-term care policies requiring genetic tests. We do not condone failure to provide benefits to people who need them because they have a condition or a genetic predisposition toward one, and we don't accept the widespread practice of segmented risk. In fact, I'm appropriately committed to looking at these long-term care insurance practices in depth with an eye to providing better and more protective standards, and commend you for drawing attention to this issue.
I would claim my time. I thank the gentleman for his comments. I think that long short becomes the ultimate in cherry picking, and I think the American people have had enough of that. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will withdraw the amendment and look forward to it. So did you want to, I'd be glad to yield.
Without,
Mr. Green.
Without objection, members will try to show up. We will withdraw the amendment. I recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to follow up both on what both my colleagues in California said, both. I was going to ask you because of the concern we had
I know it's been 12 years since the Bitcoin was done with first standards, but in that 12 years, there's a new product on the market. It's called long-term care. And if we make a policy statement that says you should not be punished for your genetic makeup because you can't control it, then for healthcare, then it would seem like it's flowing into this new product. It's also long-term care. And it flies in the face of what we've been saying on the federal level for years to the baby boomers. Plan for your long-term care, and if you buy this product, but if we're going to have selected marketing, selected picking of other people who don't have those markers, you won't have what insurance is about to spread the risk. And that's why I'm glad we're going to follow up and maybe the separate legislation I said, Congressman Waxman's experience on government foreign oversight on the federal government's product that's offered to federal employees, but I also know that in our community, that if you can afford long-term care, you need to be able to purchase it. And that way, hopefully, not impact the Medicaid system that we're seeing, because it's interesting, Medicaid dollars, 60%, I believe, of the money that we take goes to long-term care for seniors. You get the numbers that the general might be in front of us. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I know what we're doing.
I thank the gentleman. Without objection, the amendment is withdrawn. The chair, so if we can write this around, we can perhaps be ready.
Mr. Gentleman from Florida Central.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
The reading without objection, reading the amendment is dispensed with. I read from Texas, who's recognized by this amendment for 5 minutes.
And Mr. Chairman, I think my name has already been touched on. If I'm not correct, is that right?
We need to have the clerk report it and pass it out.
Amendment to HR 493 has proposed a bill by Mr. Stearns, page 25, strike line 17, and all follows through page 26, line 10, and insert the following 17.
Without objection, reading the amendment is dispensed with. The gentleman from Florida is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to go back and remind my colleagues when we asked the question to counsel. And the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Gingham, sort of helped clarify the question in terms of preemption of this bill for states. And in fact, it was not even clear in the council's answer. He indicated this will preempt states, except if they have a more stringent requirement. But it's not that clear cut because a lot of states are doing tests for lots of things which are not in the classification of stringent. And so, in fact, this bill would exclude as many as, I think, 43 states, a lot of their testing. And I'm specifically going to give an example dealing with employers. Some of my colleagues might not have had clarity to the definition of genetic testing, which I think is currently so broad and is going to exclude a lot of the tests that are done in your state right now, and I have a list of them from Arizona right on down to Texas. Nowhere in this bill, as confirmed by the council and by Dr. Francis Collins, during the subcommittee hearing with the health subcommittee, does this bill limit genetic tests to that for disease? Further council stated it would preempt state laws if they're less stringent, and we don't see any of the 43 state laws that are as broad as this bill. And this bill rates in genetic tests for law enforcement, tissue and organ donation, occupational drug abuse testing. So, what my amendment does is make it clear that there's no discrimination because of disease, but it allows the states, and particularly employers, to have the flexibility so that they can go ahead and do such things as, for example, your blood type may be considered a genotype. Blood types A and B and O are only reflective of specific genotypes. Dr. Collins made this point clear. Such a genotype is not, however, a manifest disease or disorder. Thus, blood type testing and other tests to simply test for current health status are inappropriately included in the definition of this bill. So, I urge my colleagues to support my amendment, which is basically giving a more broader definition, and allow your states to have the testing and give the employers the opportunity, in a larger sense, to help employees help their health situations by saying, this is a test we need to do. We're going to do this test, and by so doing this test, we're not going to discriminate against you, but we're going to show you how to live a little better life as you work for our company. So I think this goes to the heart of the bill. I think that the answers from the councils clarify why we need to have this more broad definition, which is in my amendment. So, with that, Mr. Chairman, I reserve the balance of my time because I have to answer the questions.
Chair, sure, the gentlemen. Do you have any questions, gentlemen? Chair, sure, recognize each other, gentlemen, from New Jersey, Mr. Pillar, in opposition to the
I would be very bad because I know I'm running out of time, but again, I would say this is, there's a basic policy difference here that I don't think that we can paper over where the Stearns Amendment would significantly narrow, in my opinion. That's just that we're narrowing the definition of a genetic test, and it just greatly limits the protections provided by GM. But further whittling down the definition of genetic test, and the stakeholder groups, as well as many members, believe that the current definition is appropriate and sufficient, and basically close this alternative definition because it would ultimately narrow the definition and provide less protection. And it's just a basic policy difference here that means that we have to close the bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman,
I'll be very
brief. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be very brief. Let me be very specific on this because what we're talking about is preemption of state statutes. And this bill says if the state statute is more restrictive than this statute, then the state statute would be allowed to prevail. Let me take specifically my state of Georgia, which has a genetic testing bill in place, but it has exceptions to it. And I would ask counsel if they would work with me on three specific exceptions that are in my state statute and tell me whether or not they would be preempted and therefore not affected, or whether or not they would be considered to be more restrictive and therefore prevail as they are on our state level. The first one is it says genetic testing shall not include routine physical measurements. Would that still be allowed in the state of Georgia under this bill?
Congressman, first of all, I don't have the Georgia statute in front of me, but let me just add my work for it. Speak broadly here. Title I of GNA deals with health insurance. So the matter to which you refer is the decision of a health insurer to issue a policy to charge a premium or a right of pre-existing exclusion policy. If GM would apply, they're talking about a kid who goes down that is right, and they're talking about the genetic or human genetic information. I think the general point is what they're going to be questions. And is that some of the examples that are being given is with the outside of the scope of GM? Some of the tests are not genetic tests per se. If there's an answer to that, I'm trying to abide by the general policy that I've been doing in the Georgia statute. So I don't know if you're talking about an employer being genetic.
What it says that it does not include genetic testing, does not include routine physical measurements, and the Georgia statute is not less restrictive or is a federal statute or is it a
state?
Yes.
The language that's in the Stearns Amendment is taken from the slot of data in the 190 Congress. It's the exact language. What we're trying to do is not mess with the effort with the utility bill, but make it possible to get routine medical practice and not have some of those tests classified now as genetic tests and that information is genetic information. But the Stearns definition is definitely different than what's in the utility bill, but it's exactly what the original sponsor had. Several congresses in it.
But if I may continue, the specific exemptions are state statute, chemical blood urine analysis, test for drug abuse,
Thank you.
legal status, or convey new legal rights to fetuses or embryos. So the amendment provides the proper balance between providing protections from genetic discrimination while not addressing other non-germane issues. And again, I want to add my thanks to Mr. Stupak, our committee staff, and everybody else for helping us work out this compromise. And with that, I give back.
Just commend the gentlewoman from Colorado, the gentleman from Michigan, for the outstanding work they did. There's a further discussion of the matter. Is it the distinguished gentleman from Texas seeks recognition?
Briefly, just simply support it. And I would like to thank Mr. Pitts and his entire staff and work to get this compromise for the rest of the world.
Well, Chair, thanks to gentlemen. Chair is well observed that the committee is clear. I think with remarkable decency and remarkable ability, I'm very proud to be a member of this committee and be a fellow student of the school. There's a further discussion. Mr. Chairman, you've been a strong advocate for keeping our jurisdiction on this committee. And I would urge you, as this bill goes forward to the House and to the President, that I think the Secretary of Health and Human Services should come back to you and to Mr. Brown with an annual report on the science, what tests are applicable under this bill every year, so that you can have a hearing and an understanding how this is operating and, in fact, what are the tests that are applicable, so that the confusion that the Council has had and the Council has not, too. And Mr. Peel from Georgia has pointed out some, I think, concerns in the argument. So I urge you in the, Mr. Duggan, I would like to join you, I would be glad to hear. I'm very grateful to the gentleman. I'm very much compliment the gentleman for the point you raised, but also for the other good work that you spent today. The chair will instruct the staff to put this in the report. So that we do get the proper attention from the Secretary, and we will see to it that this matter is approved with diligence by the Department of Health.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Is there further discussion of the bill? Or the amendment? We have the vote on the amendment. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. The question now comes on recording the bill with the usual instructions. All in favor indicate by the sign of aye. Those no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. And the bill is ordered to report it with the usual instructions. The chair asks unanimous consent that the staff be authorized to make technical and confirming changes to the bill reported with consistent with the actions of the committee. The chair wants to say something here about the members of this committee. It's a great committee. I'm proud of the members. I'm proud of the work we did. The staff worked very hard on this on both sides, and they deserve the appreciation of the committee.
Mr. Chairman,
a gentleman seeks recognition for one purpose.
I'd like to ask a parliamentary inquiry.
Gentlemen, will stay.
We know in order to get the ballot reported to jurisdiction with that report the bill today. Your understanding, our verbal understanding, is that we are all going to work together on the floor and going towards the Rules Committee. We already will lay some of the normal time restrictions with the understanding that you as chairman would work with us to make sure we have the adequate time to put additional views into the record and with the report.
Yes, and the question raised by the gentleman from Texas, the chairman of work is my good friend from Texas, and they'll do our little best to see to it that the concerns that are expressed, and we'll try and see to it that the report is filed in proper fashion. We'll try and see that the provider is consulted on that matter, and we'll also try and see to it that the provider's views, if necessary, we'll find a place in the report. And I'm not quite sure how we're going to do that down the time constraints, but we'll do our best.
Thank you, Chair.
All right. Is there further business to come before the committee? With congratulations to my colleagues, the committee declares, the chair declares the committee is adjourned.